recall that Joe DiAguati spoke to us about 10, 12 years ago. I think it was 1993.
A couple of times.
It's always a good sign when they get invited back for seconds. The Honorable Joseph DiAguati has had a 22-year career, 12 of them as a tax partner with the international accounting firm of Arthur Andersen, one of the first public advocates of governmental fiscal responsibility. In November of 84, he brought his extensive professional and volunteer experience to Congress when he became the first practicing certified public accountant ever elected to our Congress. In Congress, he took the lead in sounding the call for truth in federal budgeting, accounting, and reporting, and in bringing financial accountability to Capitol Hill. He was the original author of the Chief Financial Officers Act, signed by President Bush in 1990, which mandated the assignment of a chief financial officer to each major department and agency of the U.S. government. He also distinguished himself by finding bipartisan solutions to difficult problems. On issues of local concern, he founded and co-chaired the Congressional Long Island Sound and Hudson River caucuses, which secured vital increases in federal support for these embattled waterways. In 1986, with the late Democratic Congressman Vicki Whelan, DiAguati initiated legislation to confer Congressional Medals of Honor on Black World War I and World War II military heroes, thereby correcting an historic injustice. More recently, he co-founded with Congressman Gerald Nadler of New York the New York Task Force for Port, Rail, and Industrial Development in order to restore lost jobs to New York's manufacturing and transportation industries. Since leaving the Congress in 1989, he established a nonpartisan foundation, Truth in Government, through which he continues his crusade for federal fiscal reforms. He is the author of Unaccountable Congress, It Doesn't Add Up, and every one of you got a copy of this book. It is a terrific read, and it's very important. He is a frequent speaker on fiscal responsibility and public accountability. In August of 94, as a keynote speaker at the annual conference of the American Accounting Association, he persuaded professors of accounting to play an active role in federal budgeting and financial management. And in May of 96, he returned to Washington as a keynote speaker on federal financial management reforms before the Institute of Management Accountants. This is formerly the National Association of Accountants. Joe DiAguati is the recipient of numerous awards and honors, including investiture as a Knight of Malta, the International Humanitarian Award, the Boys Town of Italy, the Outstanding CPA Government Award from the New York State Society of CPAs, the Torch of Liberty Award from the New York State Conservative Party, the Outstanding Public Service Award from the Westchester County Republican Committee, the Westchester Irish Committee's Dedication to Peace and Justice Award, and last but certainly not least, Rotary's Paul Harris Fellow Award. Will you please join me and give a very warm Rotary welcome to the outstanding American
I feel like I'm running for something here. What an introduction. That's always a possibility. You know, I was shocked when I found out that I was the first and only practicing certified public accountant elected to either the House or the Senate in 1985. Now, I'll bet you never knew that. Now, how many members of Congress are there? 535. You have 100 senators, 435 members of the House. Only five had CPA designations, but none of them practiced. They were attorneys who were in states who didn't have the practice requirements, so therefore they practiced as attorneys, but they also held themselves out to tax matters, I guess, estate planning as CPAs. But no one practiced as I did for 22 years in a great accounting firm. Arthur Andersen, the Marines of Accounting back then, I left it in 1984. To me, it's a tragedy when you could remove 80,000 people from their jobs. That was not necessary. It wasn't necessary to melt down five firms into four. It happened, bad government policy. Arthur Andersen should have settled it, they didn't. Bad judgment on their part, but you have now a great firm that's out of the works. They should have indicted and arrested three partners in Houston where the damage was done. They shouldn't have taken on a whole firm, and Arthur Andersen doesn't know or didn't know the power of the U.S. government. Because when you're a target, you know how justice switches. You're innocent until proven guilty. But when you're a target for any indictment, it shifts around. They hound you. They harass you. And somehow, Anderson didn't realize when the whole government is after you, you better find some way to stop. Now, let me give you an image here. I'll bet few in this room know what this is. It has my picture on it, but a version of it is on the cover of this book. Did you know that congressmen vote with a plastic card, the same shape as your credit card? This is a little smaller because I had to trim it to fit into my wallet. I use this for security in Washington these days. It doesn't work to vote anymore. That was taken away when I left the U.S. Congress. But I carry it because I use it as a symbol, as I did in the front of this book. Because really, this is more than a voting card. This is the most expensive credit card in the world. This is a congressional voting card. Every time this card goes in, at the end of a row of seats in the House of Representatives, and you're not there to see it all the time, and if you were in there, you'd see the lights of every congressman, 435. If he or she votes yes, it's a green light. If they vote no, it's a red light. If they abstain, it's a yellow light. And at the end of 15 minutes, everybody knows how they voted. Or if they change their vote under pressure, you know. That's our transparency in government. But this card, to me, is the credit card. Why? Because every time it goes in, you're raising the national debt. And when I wrote this book 10 years ago, I thought things were horrible. The national debt was about $3.5 trillion. Now we know, because we just raised the debt ceiling, it's $7.3 trillion and rising. And that's the good news. The bad news is that's on the cash basis. Imagine if the government was required to keep its books on the accrual basis that it mandates on every publicly held company in America. Any board, and I'm on the boards of some companies, that's how I make a living, their officers would be indicted, and I dare say convicted, if they used the system that is being used by the U.S. government. You might say, well, Joe, how could this happen? Why isn't anybody changing it? Well, you know how it is in America. We've got Iraq, we've got Iran, we've got nuclear proliferation, we've got the Middle East crisis, we've got so many other things, and when you start talking about numbers, people tend to, you know, not fall asleep, but they tend to think about other things. And this is a crisis in the making. It's not just Social Security. The theme of my speech today, as you're going to hear, is really, what's the truth? Are we getting numbers that are honest? Are we getting numbers that are true? Can you trust the numbers? If you went out to buy a business, you got to trust those numbers. If you did anything with respect to your family or business, you need numbers to make decisions. Today in government, those numbers are controlled by politicians. I don't think the founding fathers ever realized that numbers would play such a crucial role in our system. We have an independent Federal Reserve System. We have an independent judiciary. We know that we have an independent legislature that has checks and balances with the Senate and the House. Why don't we have some independent court or agency dealing with numbers so politicians cannot pick the numbers they like? And even today, you've got the Congressional Budget Office. They give their numbers. You have the Office of Management and Budget. The president with the big bully pulpit, he has his numbers. And you can go and ask the Comptroller General, and I'm sure, although he has to audit those numbers, he'll give you his viewpoint. And since he is a CPA, one of my former partners from Arthur Andersen, he agrees with everything I'm saying because I've seen his speeches and articles in the professional publication that there is a crisis, and it's the numbers that we're using. The article that I left with you, if you have it, I hope you have it, it's the one that was published by the National Law Journal. Now, I could have given you a lot of articles, and for those of you who want to know more, I didn't want to bury you. These are the editorials that I've written in the last 2 or 3 years, and you'd be, you know, I'd be happy to see you pick this up and take it with you. I think I write in good English and understandable English, let's put it that way, with a complicated subject. And these are op-eds from the Washington Times, the Gannett Papers, the Washington Post, and other things, so that there are people that are interested in this, but not enough people are doing something about it. And how we get that to happen is one of the biggest problems I think our country faces today. Now, if you look at this credit card in the front of this book, what did I say over here? And I think this tells the point. It says credit line, unlimited, expiration date, never, bill to future generations. And that's basically what we're doing today. Every time we vote, we're passing it on to the next generation, hoping that this will be a way to solve the problem. There are many problems that I can talk about. I don't want this to be, of course, a one-on-one in the county, but let me just give you some of the things that I think are real crises. Going back to the issue of the budget and the issue of our county, the article that I gave you basically starts off about Enron. It's cooking the nation's books. Now, why I'd like you to have that article is it's not Joe Giovanni just speaking, because to get that article in the National Law Journal, which goes to 30,000 attorneys across America, they had to check everything I said. And the reason why I wanted them to publish the article is people can't believe it when I tell them that there was a Hoover Commission in the early 50s, and Truman acted on that Hoover Commission and mandated a cool accounting. Believe it or not, the accounting that reports things, not when the cash flows, but when you have an obligation to pay something, that's called a liability, or a right to receive something, that's an asset, even though you don't have physical possession of it. That's the way the books should be run, because that's the way the books are run in corporate America, and any CPA that does an audit will tell you that's generally accepted accounting principles, and that's the way it's got to be. Well, that system was mandated in 1950, and it was determined at that time that it would take several years to implement it. It's 55 years later, and that system still has not been implemented. Now, why? Because the people are not forcing the issue on that. They don't know enough about this, and they just let it go. Therefore, politicians, whether it's the president or whether it's congressmen, they're able to talk about any numbers that favors their position. And that's the problem we have. So I wanted that article there because it shows that there's credibility in saying that. But there's another thing that happened last year. Another very credible figure, and it's in the article, Alan Greenspan, in giving his testimony before a congressional committee in February 2003, where he was talking about the dangers of these deficits now going up to $500 billion in 1 year, he mentioned that, by the way, I'm not happy, comfortable with the accounting, and there should be the accrual basis. It's in that article as well. And if you want to see the letter I sent to Greenspan congratulating him, it's in this package, okay? Now, he's got enough other things to worry about. We couldn't get him to be a leader. I tried to get him to come out publicly to be a leader on this issue. Maybe when he retires, he'll do something like that. But the public has to know that there are important people like the Comptroller General, David Walker, many of the old Comptroller Generals like Elmer Statz, head of the Government Accounting Service Board, people like Alan Greenspan, people like myself who was on the inside, and there not many CPAs can say that. Maybe there's still only one I haven't checked to see if there's any other practicing CPAs since I was there. And somehow we have to form a network of these people, and I hope to do that. I've been consumed on my volunteer activities helping my father's people, because, by the way, my mother's born in Bari, so she's fully Italian, for those non-Italians who are here. I'm blessed to have two immigrant parents that came here because of the Depression. You know, they came here with the Italian immigration in the late 20s because there were no jobs in Italy. And that's the beauty of America, that you can come here with nothing, and neither one of them had an education that went past the eighth grade and didn't learn how to speak English until they were here. And I was kind of raised in a grocery store in what is now called the South Bronx, where I went to school, at Fordham University and Fordham Prep. So this is the beauty of America and the promise of America, that people could come here with practically nothing, but if they work hard, things happen in America. Well, I'm blessed, as many of you are, as all of you are. We're here, and we're successful. And what are we doing with our lives? Are we just making money? No, you're Rotarians. Obviously, you're interested in serving others. That's the purpose of being a Rotarian. I looked all over for my Rotary member pin today, so I got one of yours. But I did find my Paul Harris Fellow Award from 20 years ago. I had it in one of the things. Let me bring that. And why did I get that? Because I was a volunteer, not only in Arthur Anderson, but in Congress, doing things that we needed. Many people would say, how are you as a Republican an environmentalist? You started the Long Island Sound Caucus with Torricelli, a Democrat. You started the Hudson River Caucus with Torricelli. You started the Long Island Sound Caucus with the Democrat Mrazek and the guy that was serving, Bruce, I forget his last name now, but he was serving as the congressman from New Haven, Bruce Morrison. And, but it was important. Why? My district was surrounded by two wonderful bodies of water that were both dying. We saw the fish come to the surface in the Long Island Sound, and we saw the PCB problems is now being solved after 20 years. The point is that this issue of accounting is now one that I'm going to spend a lot more time on. Now that we've got the internet, now that we've got, and I do have a website if you want to see it. It hasn't yet been activated in the way that others have been, but there's a website called truthingovernment.com. If you want to see my history, it's there. Let me just point out a couple of things, because you're going to take this book with you. And by the way, there are other copies of the book. If you want to take some for your friends, your family, please be my guest. My foundation just buys as many copies of this book as possible and hands it out, mainly at universities when I speak, because I want the younger generation to know what's going on with their money. But feel free to take as many copies as another box back there. But I wanted you to see how I tried my best to wake up my friends in Congress to this issue. And in the back, you'll see an appendix with articles that I wrote. And they're on page 104. Is an article I wrote to then Republican Conference Chairman Dick Cheney. Okay? Now, why did I write that? Because I had been so upset about the numbers game that I saw as a new congressman in 85 that I had the temerity to send a letter to Ronald Reagan, who was, by the way, very happy that I won because I took a Democratic district into the Republican, and I became pretty friendly with him. I got many, many letters from him, and it was very good that he helped me in my elections. But it gave me a reason to then use that relationship as a surprise congressman to him, and basically because of him, he had big coattails. I only won by 1,000 votes, so I hold him responsible for it. The point is, I sent it to Reagan showing that the books are so messed up that if you converted the books to the accrual basis, you will find that Jimmy Carter was the biggest deficit spender, not you, Mr. President, because we don't have a capital budget. And since you spent a lot of your money on things that should have been capitalized, rebuilding the military and other things, and Carter spent, as a Democrat would, spent a lot more money on government programs, which you would write off, the books are not telling the real story. Now, I get a nudge on the floor one day from Dick Cheney. Now, you know, he's the vice president, he was Secretary of Defense, and he says, Joe, they're all talking in the White House about your memo, but why is there such a big difference between the cash and the accrual basis? This is accounting 101. Here is Dick Cheney asking me. So what I did is I went back to school at Arthur Anderson. I got hooked up with my partners there again. And I said, you guys are going to have to help me write this letter because it's going to the White House. And there it is. I wrote it to Dick Cheney explaining what was the big difference between the cash and the accrual basis in the federal government. Obviously, things like Social Security are not on the books. We don't put the, you know, the obligation for it. The fact that we don't have a capital budget is an issue. If you had a capital budget, you'd have to record some depreciation. So I kind of gave all the big items right here. There's another letter I'm very proud of, and that's the letter that George Bush number one, senior, sent to me in 1990 after he signed my bill. I lobbied as a congressman 4 years, and you can't understand, you can't imagine how difficult it was to get through to other congressmen that this was an important issue. But after 4 years, they finally passed my bill to bring a chief financial officer and to improve financial management in the Congress. And it's only now, 15 years later, George Bush's letter to me is in here. Dear Joe, that is saying, you know, sorry you're not here, because he signed it a year after I left Congress. But 15 years later, we're finally seeing the fruits of that bill, because now every agency, almost 30 of them, and department, agency or department, have a chief financial officer. And now the reports that they're putting out are almost on the accrual basis. It's a quasi-accrual basis report, but they do have a lot of footnotes to tell you what the differences are. And now instead of 180 days after the fiscal year, which is September 30th, or 90 days, which it was up until last year, now it's 45 days. So they're getting much better. It's improving. But what's the issue? The issue really is it's not enough. Because if you don't use that accounting system in the budget process, before you spend the money, it does no good. It's nice to know afterwards what it was on the right accounting basis and what it was on the cash basis, but it's too late. The year's over, you spent the money. So So we need to get this budget process, we need to get the accrual system into the budget process. That's where it's going to be a problem. Why is it a problem? Because politicians don't want you to think that on their watch, it's worse than what you think it is. They always want to pass it on to the next generation. So while they don't mind you having now financial statements that begin to tell that there's some differences, you cannot take away the money they want to spend in their districts, which many times gets them elected, obviously. And that's what would happen once you expose that the real deficit last year was not $500 billion, but if you included what you had to do to account properly for Social Security, using the rules that accountants have to use with actuaries, and you put on the books the cost of many of the loan programs that we have, which we never record until there's a bailout. Like, remember RTC, savings and loan? We never accrued for any of that. It was only when everything went bust, they then had to run out and find $500 billion. And what did they do? The biggest trick in the world. They said, that is an extraordinary item, so therefore it should not be put in the budget, but yes, we have to go out and borrow for it. So they put the RTC off budget, off the books, the national debt was raised by $500 billion, but you never knew it because it never went through the deficit. Today, accountants would tell you, that's what they used to do in accounting 50 years ago, when you, if you had an item you didn't like, you would charge it to surplus and not go through the P&L. Today, accountants have to put everything through, no matter what it is. If it's an extraordinary item, you label it as such, but it's gotta go through the profit and loss. Not everything goes through the profit and loss in Washington, so you never know what the real financial results for the year are, even on a cash basis. Now, my final point. What did Enron hit? Obviously, they had orders. You might say, well, what happened? It was independently audited. Well, we know those orders had infirmities, and that's what happened to Arthur Andersen. But worse than that, what was the biggest infirmity? They were doing things off the books. They had what they called special purpose enterprises, SPEs. And they rigged them up in such a way with the help of, I'm not gonna mention names, but Wall Street houses, who got big fees out of this, so that it looked like they were not really in control of these things and could say, well, that's not my debt. Well, it turns out it was their debt, but it never got on the books, okay? And therefore, when you had to redo the books, you found out that Enron was in really bad shape. Now, why do I make that point? Because it's in my article. You've got the same situation in New York State, and probably every state in the union, or most of them, and in the federal government. In the federal government, those SPEs are called government-sponsored enterprises, GSEs. What are they? Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, the Government Accounting Standards, the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, the Resolution Trust Corporation. There's almost another 30 of them running around that are not in the budget process, not on the books. And they still can use the full faith and credit of the U.S. government in floating bonds. You saw what happened to Fannie Mae, the hubris on these people that are making $10 billion a year, trying to say they knew more than the accountants. I got a Fannie Mae file right here because I've been tracking that. Here it is. It's gotten thick and thicker, all the articles. It's a classic case in political influence. All the leaders of Fannie Mae had rabbis, had sponsors in Congress. And anytime there was anything issued or raised, they ran right there. And it was squelched. Finally, it couldn't be squelched anymore, and we find out now they had to be fired, and it's got to be reorganized. How many other of these government-sponsored enterprises there's a problem with? At least Fannie Mae had an audit outside. The others don't. So that's a problem. What about New York State? You're living in New York State. You know what it's called in New York State? Not SPEs, not GSEs. They're called authorities. The MTA is an authority. The canals have authorities. The Thruway has an authority. There's another, Lord knows how many of them, at least 20. There's a report that Hevesy put out on that I'm going through right now. And guess what? They're all off the books. They're not in the budget process. That's what Brodsky, good Democrat up there, is yelling about. And I appreciate what him and Spitzer are doing, even though I'm a Republican. Because we need these loudmouths. We need these watchdogs that are raising these issues, maybe partly for politics, but I believe they are doing us a great service. And we need to be more bold. I have to be more bold. And you need to inform yourselves. You are business leaders. And you need to be more bold. Because the next generation is going to suffer on this. Well, with that, I have a few minutes for questions.
Okay.
All right, thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me again. I hope. By the way, let me bring some levity to this, because there are four key players in this whole thing. There are accountants, there are actuaries, there are politicians, and there are lawyers. Boy, what a group, huh? Because I may get tongue-tied on this one, I usually don't resort to notes when I speak on anything, but this one is beautiful. It had been given to me years and years ago, and while I was preparing for this, I found it. I said, I gotta read this to you, because this is great. And why is there a problem today? Well, we know actuaries are important, because when you're thinking about things like Social Security and Medicare, you gotta make assumptions, and you gotta figure out what your real debt is and what's coming. And that's what they do. Trouble is, if you talk to one actuary versus another, you got different assumptions. So there's a problem. We know that accountants are important because they're trying to keep a baseline so that we know where we're going, and hopefully we get more outside auditing, not just these government accountants doing it. And attorneys, well, guess what? When I left the Congress, what did I leave behind? I left behind 276 attorneys. I was the only CPA. Imagine a place with 276 lawyers and no accountant. That's Congress. Now, I thought this says it all, and I'm going to read it to you. Why is it that accountants are hostages to attorneys and actuaries? This says it best. An attorney is said to be a man who knows a very little about a great deal and keeps knowing less and less about more and more until he knows practically nothing about everything. On the other hand, an actuary is a man or a woman who knows a great deal about very little and who goes along knowing more and more about less and less until finally he knows practically everything about nothing. An accountant starts out knowing practically everything about everything, but ends up knowing nothing about anything due to his association with attorneys and actuaries.